Hi everyone, good evening. So today's session is all about web development. One note for all of you, the session is being recorded and all the recordings of this session will be available at bolt.io/workshops link. The link will be provided at the end. Can you please mute anyone has their mic in unmute? Can you please mute your mic? Yeah, thank you. And all the code which I have used in this project will be available in the GitHub repository, and the link for it as well will be given in the chat window at the end. And since I'm sharing my screen, I'm not able to view the chat window. If anyone of you has any doubts, we can have a Q&A session at the end. The last 15 minutes, we can have a Q&A session, and all of you can ask your doubts there at that time, and I will try to clear all of them. Okay. We shall start. Sorry?
No, ma'am.
Yeah. Tell me.
Ma'am.
If you have any doubts, you can ask in the Q&A session at the end, which is we'll give you 15 minutes to ask your questions. So please wait until we complete the session. Yeah, thank you. We shall start now. So today's session is all about web development, and I'm sure that this session would be interesting, and I hope you learn a lot from this session. Hi, I'm Gaunisha Ganavi. I'm currently a web developer intern at Bolt IoT. I got this internship after I completed the web development training, which is provided by Bolt IoT team. And don't worry, I'll tell all about the internship experience and all the training experience at the end of the session. And I'll also tell you how you can get an internship at Bolt IoT as me. And this internship is also provided with stipend every month. And I shall talk about more about this internship at the end. I love web development, and I'm here to share my knowledge with you all. And all my tips and tricks which I use in my projects, which will help you a lot in your projects as well. So in today's session, you will learn all the basics of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. And I'll give you some tips to create some great responsive websites. And you will also learn how to create a simple door lock system dashboard using HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. And I will also talk about how to get internship opportunities as a web developer. So talking about first, we'll dive into HTML. HTML stands for Hypertext Markup Language. I think most of you know about HTML because in 12th standard itself, you would have learned it. So HTML is really easy to learn, and everybody love HTML to learn. HTML, it is the standard language for creating websites. HTML describes the structure of a web page. The structure of a web page in the sense, like if you're, for example, if you're designing a web page for yourself, for a portfolio for yourself, then you must know the structure of your web page, like your name, like Gaunisha Ganavi, must come as the heading, and some information like I am studying this, I'm working at here, and so, your information must be given in a paragraph. And if you wish, you can also include an image of yours at the and in the left-hand side. So this is the structure of the web page. So where all the elements should go, right? So that is the structure of the web page that is described by HTML. And HTML has a series of elements. These elements are used to structure the web page, okay? We'll learn more about this as we go on. So this program is a basic, typical HTML file, HTML code. So each and every HTML tag is enclosed within the open angular braces and closed angular braces. So each and every HTML tag is enclosed inside the angular braces. And this starting, the first line which we see is called as the document type declaration. So the document type declaration is actually optional, but it is a good practice which you can include in your code, which describes what type of document you are trying to run. So in this case, it is an HTML document. So we write it as with an angular brackets, exclamatory mark, doc type and HTML. You may ask, does this doc type should be in caps or not? No, HTML is not case sensitive. You can use any uppercase or lowercase letters, but it is a good practice to write all the HTML tags in a lowercase. Okay, so this is document type declaration. And now this is the tag information. Like a HTML, each and every HTML tag has a start tag as well as its respective end tag. The start tag is enclosed within normal angular braces, and the end tag has a forward slash preceding the name of the tag. So what is an HTML element? An HTML element is something which includes the start tag as well as the end tag and all the elements which are enclosed in within the start tag and the end tag. So the whole component is called as an element of an has an element in HTML. So some points to remember are the HTML tag is element is the root of the HTML document. So that one that should be written first in an HTML document, in all HTML document. And all tags have their corresponding end tags. As I said, tags have a corresponding end tags, which has a forward slash in the beginning of the name of the tag. And but there are some exceptions, like the image tag, img tag, or br tag, or hr tag. They do not have a closing tag like slash img or slash br. We don't have that one. It is so these tags are called as empty tags. Okay. And HTML is not case sensitive, as I said you earlier. And attributes and IDs. At each and every HTML element has attributes, has its own attributes. The attributes provide additional information about elements. So if you have an H1 element, let me show you an example. Like if you have an H1 element like this, you can have its own attribute. Like you can have an attribute name with its corresponding value. Like I can give it as head1, right? So this name is called as the attribute, and after the equal to sign we have its corresponding value. Okay, the value of the HTML attribute is enclosed within double quotes. Okay, and inside the H1 tag, you can give it as hello or any other text you wish to have. Okay, and so this is HTML attribute. Attributes are always specified in the start tag. Okay, we don't give the attribute in the end tag like this. So this is not correct. We have to give the attribute in the start tag only. And IDs. Each and every HTML element has its own ID, okay? Like you are in college, right? So we have our own respective register numbers. Like if I call register number one, the person who has register number one will come. Nobody has the same register number, right? In the same way, each and every HTML tag has its own unique ID. No two HTML tags should have the same ID. You can have unique ID. Each and every HTML tag should have their unique ID. So they can have same names, like this H1 tag as well as this H1 tag can have the same names like head1 and head1. But the ID of each and everything tag should be different. Like I cannot have the same ID for this one and this one. This is wrong. You have to have unique ID. Like I have H2 for this one and H3 for this one. ID names, the values of the ID can be anything you want. You can put it like apples, fruits, and everything you wish, but it should be different for each and every tag. Okay. So these are the commonly used HTML tags. We shall all of these tags are explained in detail in the training, in the web development training given by Bolt IoT. I should just give a gist of the tags, and most of the, I've also used some of these tags in the project. I shall explain you in detail when we go there. And first one is the H1 to H6 tag. This is the heading tag. It defines the most important heading as well as the least important heading. There are six heading tags, H1, H2, H3, H4, H5, and H6. We can have each and every heading tag has its own font size, and its own size of the font, that is font size. Okay, H1 is the highest font size, and H6 is the has the least font size. And in between, H2, H3, H4, and H6 are in decreasing order. So H2 tag has the font size a little lesser than H1. H3 tag has the font size a little less than H2, and H4 has the font size a little less than H3, and so on. So the smallest will be H6. And table. If you want, I can just give a H6. Hello. So if I run this one, you can see that H1 tag, the text enclosed inside the H1 tag will be with larger font size, and inside the H6 tag is little smaller, is the more smaller. Okay, so this is the difference between H1 and H6 tag. And table tag. Table tag is used to create a table within the HTML document. Input tag. Input tag is used to define an input field within an HTML document. Input field in the sense, if you wish to log into Facebook or Instagram or any other website you wish, they'll ask you to enter a login information, your email as well as your password credentials, right? So you'll be given a box to enter your email and password. So that box is called as an input field. To create an input field in HTML document, you need an input tag. So that tag is the input tag. And the B tag. B tag is used to make the text bolder. And button tag is used to create a button like submit button or login button. All those buttons will be used to will be created using the button tag. And div tag. This div tag is a little more important. It defines a division or section within the HTML document. The div tag doesn't have any function on its own. Like if you have the button tag and the B tag, like it makes something to the text. Which encloses it, right? The div tag on its own doesn't have any function to the elements enclosed in it, but you can style the elements by grouping the elements in an HTML document into a div. So, for example, if I enclose these both H1 tags and H6 tag inside this div, so I'm enclosing this H1 tag and H6 tag inside this div, right, with a class name as header. Class is also an attribute of the tag, and the value given is header. So this is your wish. You can give anything you want. So I'm giving the style of it to be color, font color as red. Okay, I'll save it, and then I see here both the H1 as well as the H6 tag has the font color red, right? So I need not go and specifically give styling to each and every H1 tags or H6 tag, which I have enclosed inside it. You just can group it into a single div and give a styling for this for the div tag, and it will automatically go for each and every element which is enclosed inside the div tag. It may let it be a large full table also. It the font color will be red for all the elements inside the which is enclosed inside the div tag. And we have the form tag, which is used to define an HTML form. Like you can use a login form or a register form and everything, whatever you wish. All these are being given in the training in detail. I'm just giving the important ones alone and giving an example of it. And head tag is used to define the head section of an HTML document. HR tag is used to apply thematic break between paragraph level elements. Like if I give an HR tag here and save the file, you can see there is a break between the H1 tag and the H6 tag. So this is the use of it. And style tag is used to provide style information for an HTML document. Like if you have one HTML page, and that page should be, that whole page should be given one styling, you can use the style tag. Style tag always comes inside the head tag. So this is the HTML tag, and this is the head tag. HTML tags usually contain two main tags, head as well as the body. Okay, the head tag encloses all the elements you wish to include in the HTML document, like the title of the document. The title of the document, which will be displayed here, right? It is document. If you want to name it as document one, example, then it will be changed as example. Okay, so that is the title. And you can also give the style tag, which encloses all the styling of the HTML page. And if you are including Bootstrap, or if you are including Ajax, or if you are including Google Fonts in your HTML document, you can include all those links here in the HTML, in the head tag. And the body tag will contain the content of the HTML page. The content in the sense what you will be, what the user will be displayed on the screen. Like the content of the HTML page, which in the sense this hello on the underline, like that. So I'm speaking about the style tag. So I'm styling the whole document. I'm giving the this whole page a background color of violet. In the sense, you can use it in the style tag and enclose it inside the head tag. So when I refresh it, you can see that the whole page turns into a violet color, right? So you can use the style tag to style the whole web page. And we have the span tag. Span tag is used for styling and grouping inline elements. Inline elements in the sense, the elements which are not one single line of a paragraph or one single word in a paragraph. So all these are can be enclosed inside a span tag. So if I use a span tag here, like I'm using my name, Hello Gaundisha, and I'm giving the background color for it as background color red. And for the div, I'm giving the background color as blue. So you see here, this is my name, which has been displayed here. This is enclosed inside the span tag, right? So since span is an inline element, as we saw in the PPT, span is an inline element, so it doesn't take the whole width of the page, okay? It just takes the size of the element which is enclosed inside it, and hence the background color red has gone only to the content, Gaunisha. And if you, as we see here in the hello and this H1 and H6 tag, we have enclosed these both inside a div tag. Div is a block level element. Block level element in the sense it takes the whole width of the page. So if I give background color for this and this, this whole div tag, it doesn't take the background color of the content alone. It instead, it takes the whole width of the page. So that should be noted when it comes to div tag and span tag. And script tag is used to include the JavaScript within the HTML document. And BR tag is also used to insert a line break inside the HTML document. And that's all about the basics of HTML. In detail about HTML is being given in the web development training, which I'll be telling at the end of the session. And moving on to CSS. CSS means stands for Cascading Style Sheet. So we all know that HTML is used to structure the web page, right? And if you want to design that elements in HTML elements, you want CSS. You want to look it, make it look beautiful. You want CSS. And if you have both CSS and HTML, you can create way better looking websites and your web page will look great. Okay. And more about CSS, it tells how HTML elements are to be displayed on screen. Like if you're giving a paragraph, I want this paragraph to be of font size this much. I want the color of the font to be gray, or I want the line height of the paragraph to be this much. So how you want them to be displayed on the screen, that is explained by that is programmed by CSS. And the layout of multiple web pages all at once can be given accessed using CSS. If you have 10 HTML documents for your project, okay, then you can use one single CSS file to style all the 10 HTML files using external CSS. We'll be learning about that later. And CSS also has series of properties, and each property has its own corresponding values, where which is used to design each and every HTML element. So moving on, the syntax. So this is the typical syntax of an HTML element, a CSS program, CSS code. We have the H1 and H1 tag name, and inside curly braces, you have the font size and 20 pixels. The font size as well as the color, which is given before the colon, is called the property, CSS property. And after the colon, we have the value of the corresponding property. Like for font size, you want it to be 20 pixels. And for color, the text color should be white. So these are the values, and this is the properties. And each and every CSS code is entered using semicolon. This is a must. And this H1, the before the curly braces, the H1 is called as the selector, CSS selector. Selectors are used to select which HTML element you want to design. So in this case, I want to design H1 element. So that's why I'm using the H1 simple selector. We'll talk about selectors later. So here are the selectors. The selectors are of 5 different types: simple selectors, combinator selectors, pseudo class selectors, pseudo element selectors, attribute selectors. All of this have been taught in the training in detail. I'll just give a short introduction about this. Simple selectors are used to select elements based on their name, ID, and class. Combinator selectors are used to select elements based on their specific relationship between them, descendant selector. All those things will be given, will be mentioned in combinator selectors. Pseudo class selectors are used to select elements based on certain state. So if an element is hovered with a mouse, then you use the hover pseudo class selector. And if it is a link, you use the link. If the link is visited, then you use the visited selector. And if it is active, and etc. And pseudo element selectors, it is used to select and style a part of an element. Like pseudo element selectors are used preceded with two colons and followed by the selector name. So colon. First line and colon first letter before, after, and so on. Attribute selectors are used to style the elements based on their attributes and their attribute values, like name, ID, and so on. And these are the simple selectors, the first type. So if you want to select an ID, an element with the specific ID, you use hash before it. So hash first name stands for the element with ID first name. If you want to select an element with class name, you use dot in front of it. So dot intro stands for the element with class intro. Element dot class, it selects the elements with class intro. It selects all the paragraph elements with class intro. This star is called as a universal selector. This universal selector will select all the elements in the HTML document. And you can also use an element selector like P, H1, V, as we saw in the example, H1. This selects all the H1 tags and all the paragraph elements and so on. Element, comma, element, and so on. Like if you want to give the same font size for H1 paragraph tags and for body tag, for everything, you can use the comma, comma separator, and you can give all the class tag names as you go on. And these are the combinator selectors, the descendant selector with a space, like it selects all the paragraph elements inside the elements. And there is a child selector, it selects all the elements that are children of the, okay, wow. And then adjacent sibling selector, which is represented by plus. So if you give the plus p, it selects all the first paragraph elements that are placed immediately after the elements. General sibling selects all the elements that are next sibling of the elements. You can learn a lot from the training in detail. So these are the commonly used CSS properties: background color, background image, width of the element, height of the element, padding. Padding means, if you see in this cell of the table, this text content of the cell and this border of the cell has some space in between, right? So here horizontal distance is this much and vertical distance is this much. So this is called as the padding. Margin means this table and this column and this line has a margin of 50 pixels or so on. So the margin is nothing but the space between two elements, and padding is nothing but the space between the content of the element and its border. So color means the text color, font family, which font you want to choose, font size, border style. So here border style is dotted and this one is solid. You can learn a lot, explore more with CSS. Then display. Display a property is used to control the layout. So if you want to display two div elements in a straight line, then you can use display inline block to display it in a single line and so on. Is it index? It specifies the stack order of the element. Like if you want an H1 tag to be displayed over the image, then you can use is it index is equal to 1 or is it index is equal to 10 in order to make it display above the image. And media screen is used for responsiveness of the website. If you want to display in computer screens like this much size, this much font size, and if in case of smartphones, in case of mobile phones, you want to decrease the font size, you can use media screen. And float property is used for positioning the elements. Like you want to float left or float right, we can see in the project. And there are three ways you can include CSS in HTML file. One is inline, internal, and external. Inline CSS is what we used in the programs right now. We use inside the start tag of the element, we use the style tag, style attribute, and we give the value, corresponding value, what you want to mention. So this is called as inline CSS. Inline CSS is mainly used when you want to style a particular element, one HTML element, you can use inline CSS. Internal CSS means inside the head tag. This also I showed you. Like inside the head tag, you can use the style tag and give the CSS. So this is internal CSS. Internal CSS is used when you want to a particular CSS to be given to one particular page of your project. Then you can use internal CSS. Then the external CSS is used when you have 10 pages, 10 HTML pages, and you need to style all of them. You can use one CSS file, CSS file with an extension .css, and you can include the link of the CSS file in the H section. So this is not inside the HTML page, but it is external, right? So it is called as external CSS. Like using the link tag, you can give the CSS. Now moving on to JavaScript. JavaScript is an object-based scripting language which is lightweight and cross-platform, which means it enables dynamic interactivity on websites. For example, if you see here, if you use a button or an H1 tag, whatever you click there, nothing happens. Like if I click this hello, or if I click this hello, if I click Gaunisha, if I click here, nothing happens. The page stays still, right? So using JavaScript, you can interact with this website. Like if they click the login button, what should happen? If they click a show button, what should happen? So all those interactivity will be given in JavaScript. And in HTML, JavaScript code is inserted between the script tag, as we already mentioned. And JavaScript is a case sensitive language. So if you give a name as Gaunisha with G capital, and you call a variable name with Gaunisha as G small, it shows this variable name is not defined. So if you give what variable name you've used, if you have declared, the same variable name should be used everywhere else. And it is a loosely typed language. What do you mean by loosely typed language? Like in case of, if you know C language, there you have to mention as int, A is equal to 0, int B is equal to 0, like that. But in JavaScript, you need not mention like that. You can just use var x is equal to 10, or var x is equal to a character, A, like that. You need not specify the data type of the variable. So that is called as loosely typed language. So the syntax goes like this. You need to give the var keyword for a variable, var x is equal to 10 and the value. Or you can use let keyword, let y is equal to a character, A, your wish. And DOM. What is DOM? Whenever you create a HTML file, when you load it in a browser like Chrome browser or Mozilla Firefox or anything, the HTML page is being converted into a document object model, okay? So this document object model looks like this, okay? It's like a tree-like structure. Like it contains the HTML, HTML, and it contains the head tag, the body tag, all the HTML elements is being structured as a tree-like structure. So this tree-like structure, is called as the DOM. This DOM is only can be accessed only using JavaScript. So JavaScript can add, change, or remove HTML elements directly from the DOM. JavaScript can add, change, or remove HTML attributes from using the DOM. JavaScript can add, change, or remove CSS styles. It can react to HTML events. HTML events in the sense, when somebody clicks the submit button, when somebody hovers on text, when somebody somebody scrolls down or something like that. So that is called as reacting to HTML events. JavaScript can also add or change or remove the HTML elements, HTML events. And JavaScript can display data in different ways. JavaScript can write into an HTML element. Like if you have an H1 tag, H1 element, and you want to insert some text into it, you can use inner HTML. If you want to display something on the web page, you can use document.write. If you want to insert an alert box, you can use window.alert. You can, if you want to write something on the browser console, you can use console.log. So this is the basic syntax of JavaScript. It includes document.getElementById, demo, .innerHTML is equal to the value. Document, which includes the HTML document, .getElementById is the method, and this is the parameter. Parameter is the this is the ID name which you have given in the HTML element. So what this does is, it fetches from the DOM, JavaScript fetches the HTML element with ID demo, and inside the HTML element, it gives the value as my first JavaScript. Okay, so that's all about the basics of HTML and CSS and JavaScript. Now let's move on to the website project which I've created. So this is a simple door lock system dashboard. It looks like this. This is very simple. You can also design a lot using CSS and JavaScript. And so let's dive into it. I have the HTML head and all tags. Inside the head tag, I have given, this is for bold cloud, so you need not worry about that. And I've given the link for Ajax, and I've also given the title of the document, and I've given the external CSS, as we learned now. I've given the external CSS using the link tag, rel is equal to style sheet, href is equal to style.css. Style.css, I've created a new file with extension .css. And that's all about the head part. Inside the body, I have two buttons, change password and forgot password. I have given the class names for them as change password and forgot password. And I've given the another class name. So if you have two class, you can also have two class names, which are separated by spaces, okay? And onClick. This onClick function is used to handle an HTML event. Like if they click this onClick, what should happen? It should go to this JavaScript function. So that is an HTML. OnClick is an HTML event. And the reaction to that event is you have to go to change password function. And change password and forgot password function, sorry, buttons. And I also have a go back button, which is not displayed right now. Once you go to change password, this go back button will be displayed. So all that is done using JavaScript. And I have a div called named container. One good practice is that whatever you are giving inside the web page, you can enclose it inside a container div, so that you can give all the styling using dot container. Like I've given it as dot container. This is a class name, right? Container is class name, so I have to use dot selector. And I've used an alert when password goes wrong, and this is the heading of the document. I've also given a div for enter password. So inside the div, class is equal to enter password. I've given the enter password label, and this is the input tag which we have learned. This creates this box, input box, where you can enter your password. Okay. So this is enter password label, and for the label I've given the input field. And next to it I have an open button. So for the open button, I have given the button class is equal to submit button, type is equal to submit, on click. So this is an event, HTML event. By clicking the open button, I should go to JavaScript function named submit. So I've also created, for changing the password, I've created this div. When we go to that section, I shall explain you this one. And this is the dial pad. So dial pad, I've enclosed it inside a div, a complete div. And these are all single buttons. So each and every button has an on-click event. When we click this one button, it should go to one function. So why do we have this one function is that when someone clicks this one button, one should go to inside the input box, right? So the text inside the input box should be one. So for that, I have given the functions for each and every key. I have given the function, and I have written the JavaScript function for that. And here is the reset button. Reset button, if you want to, you can use Bootstrap for it. It will be really easy. It will be given as type is equal to reset. That's it. So, but here we are not using Bootstrap. So I've used a JavaScript function for that also to reset the text box. If I enter something and if I click reset, it just vanishes. So now move on to the JavaScript. Let's move to the CSS first, and then let's go to the JavaScript. So body, for the body tag. Tag names, this is using the tag names, if you call the CSS, then it's called as simple selector. So using the tag name, I've given margin 0, padding 0, box sizing as border box, background size color, background color as dark blue, and this one. For anchor tags, A tags stands for anchor tags, which creates HTML links. If you click that, it goes to somewhere else. So that is called as anchor tag, which is used to create links. So the anchor tag in HTML, by default, it has a dark blue color, and it comes with an underline. So to remove that, I've given color inherit. Color inherit means it inherits the color which its parent has, and the text decoration to be none. Text decoration none will remove the underline from it. And if I hover, so this is pseudo class I've used here. So when I hover the HTML anchor tag, I've used the color to be pink and text decoration underline. If I hover it, I get an underline. This is the container. The container is the one which I've enclosed everything. So all this from this door lock system up to this reset button, I have enclosed it inside the container. For that container, I've given the color to be white, margin left 300 pixels. And padding, so on. Font family to be this, and etc. Enter password. Enter password is the text field. Enter password is the this label. Label I've given the margin, bottom, and font size. New password is also a label. I've given display none, so that's why it is not being displayed now. If I give display block, I'll just give display block. If I give display block. So if we give display block, this new password is being displayed here. Okay, so that's it. I give it as display none itself. So you can play around with it. And this is a text box. That is the input box. I've given the font family for it. And text box space input, which means the descendant selector, right? So every input which has the class name text box will be given this style. So I've given all the border. Border property has three values. If a CSS property has more than one value, then you can just give it separate it using spaces and give it. I've given 1 pixels. Solid means one single straight line. If you can give dotted, you can give a lot. You can explore with it. And the color to be white. So first one is the size. Second one is the type, border style. And third one is the color. This, if you you can also give it separately, like border. You can see here, border color, border width, border style. Border border size, everything, border width, that's it. You can give it in separately also, but you can also give it an, a single line like this. And this is, CSS is pretty much basic. You can just explore with it and try it out. And here comes the media screen. So if I just comment this section out, I'll just comment this section and I'll resize this Chrome page. So you can see that this doesn't look nice, right? Just the roll up system, the open button comes here. It doesn't look nice. If I go to inspect element also. So you can see this has to be scrolled in this way and the keypads are like this. So this is responsiveness. The responsiveness is weak in here in this web page. So improve your responsiveness, you include your media screen property with max width as 480 pixels. Max width 480 pixels in the sense, when it reaches 480 pixels, it goes out of this media screen. Until it is 480 pixels, it follows this CSS. After it reaches 480 pixels, it goes back to this CSS, okay? So until it reaches 480 pixels, I've given the font, I've reduced the font size, I've reduced all the margin and all the things here. So if I include it, you can see that it automatically, it looks a lot better. Okay. You can see the buttons all come in straight line, and you can see that the door lock system font is being reduced, and you can see the keypad is looking a lot better now. So this is called as responsiveness of the website. Using media screen, using CSS, you can automatic. If you don't like to use media screen, Then you can use Bootstrap framework, which is our HTML framework. You can explore with it. And we'll move on to JavaScript. We are running out of time. So in JavaScript, the main aim of this project is like you need to enter the password. If you have entered my current password is 123. If I enter the current password and click open, you just have an alert. This is an alert box. You have an alert as welcome. If I enter the wrong password, entering 111, which is the wrong password, I get an alert. Password is wrong. Try again. You have two chances left. A user gets maximum of 3 chances to enter the current password. Okay. If he misses out all the 3 chances, then he gets an alert. So let us see. I'm entering the password again. I have one chance left. And again, I'm entering the password. So alert, wrong password. And I get a Telegram message. See, alert, your door lock password has been entered wrong more than 3 times. Please check. So all this we are going to see now. Until you enter your password correctly, it doesn't go to the home page. Now I'm entering the password correctly. It goes welcome and it goes back to the same page. I've also given two options here. For change password as well as forgot password. If you click change password, if you don't wish like 123, you want to enter have another password, you can use enter your old password, which is 123, and you can also have a new password. I'm giving it as 111. Okay, and change, your password is changed. Okay, and also I get a Telegram message, your password is changed, your door lock password has been changed to 111, and go back. So I'm giving it as if I get forgot password, I forgot what the password is. Okay, then the corresponding account gets an OTP. Here is your one-time password for door lock system, 4-digit password 1613. Please do not share this with anybody. Your OTP is valid for so and so. So I'm what is the password? 1613, and you need to enter your new password. I'll enter the new password as 147. Change. So your password has been changed. Okay, you'll get the password as your password has been changed to 147, and you can click go back and enter the new password 147. Open welcome. So your password is no longer 123. Your new password is 147. So let's quickly move on to learn the JavaScript concept. I've declared the constant password is 123, and by using document.getElementById password, the ID which is used for the input field. Okay, so this input field will be taken from the DOM, and I've saved it inside the variable name called as password PWD. And if this section is nothing but I've used two input fields for change password, right? For this one and this one, I've used two input fields. So which one to be focused? Which one is on focus? And if I type that one, that element should be added. And if it is focused on this, and if I enter two, that must be added. So to ensure the focus on which input box it is given, I use this thing. document.getElementId new password is the one which is being displayed for the change password, new password. This is the input box. Okay, if that is on focus, add event listener. If it has adding an event to the input as a focus, if it is focused, then I create a function where password is equal to I change the password from this password to the element with the ID new password. Okay. And the same goes for the old password also. If I add a event listener or focus, if I focus the ID element with ID password, I change the element variable to be this password. Okay, I've given the style color is equal to white and letter spacing is equal to 5 pixels. Letter spacing means the spacing of the letters. So here I missed it out. Here the spacing of the letters is a little more, right? So letter spacing is 5 pixels. So reset function, if they click the reset button, then the value of the focused element will be null. So it becomes null. So if I click reset, it becomes null. If I click reset, it becomes null. So like that. And for all the keypads, I give the value. I add, concatenate the password's current value with the value which they have entered. If they click one, the password will add on with the string 1. So as it goes on for all the 12 elements. And to check the password, I have given three trials, right? So count is equal to 3. Function submit, when they click the submit button, when they click open button, I have printed the password's value. If the password's value, password dot value, this is an attribute. So if the password dot value is equal to the password which I have given here, which is 123. So if the password which the user has entered is equal to 123, then I give an alert welcome, and I give the header. Header means the door lock password. Okay, it's a door lock system. This one is the header. This is displayed as block, and the alert should be false. Okay, so alert becomes displayed. Alert dot style dot display none. So here document dot get elements by class name is a method with a parameter header. So it from the DOM it fetches the element with class name as header. So this method actually returns an array. Okay, so you want to access the first element with it. Okay, I have only one element as header, so that one element will be at index 0. So at array index 0, I'm giving the style dot display. If you want to access the CSS, you need to use dot style attribute, and what all property you need to use, you have to give dot dot. So I'm giving the alert to be none, and go back also should be none, and the change password should be visible. So I've given display block. Okay. If the password is wrong, suppose if they have not given the correct password, then count minus minus. This is an auto decrement operation done to the count variable. It decrements to 2. So if count is greater than 0, if all the chances has been missed out, if the count is equal to 0, if it decrements and it goes to 0, then I have to give wrong password. Sorry, if it is greater than 0, if it doesn't touch 0, they have still 2 chances left, right? And they have still 1 chance left. So I'm giving the alert as password is wrong. Try again, you have two chances left and 1 chances left. So I've given the concatenation here for the string with the variable count. And if the count value goes as less than 0, then I have else document.getElements by class name header. Header means the door lock system. This heading goes off. Like if I enter password wrong 3 times, I the door lock system heading goes off, and what do I do? This go back button and change password also goes off. Until I enter the new correct password, this page persists, right? So header should be none, alert should be block, go back should be none, and change password should be none. All this is done. And this is the AJAX code for Telegram code. This is a default Telegram link, a chat ID. You have to create a chat bot. All this will be covered in the training. And you have to create a chat bot. And this chat bot name is door lock alerts. And the text should be given as alert. %20 means space. So this is a URL code, HTTPS code for %20 for space. And alert, your password, your door lock password has been entered wrong more than 3 times. Please check. Okay. And when it is done, I give just give console.log response. That's it. Okay. So this is the AJAX code for that. Okay. This goes when they click the submit button. When they click the change password button. So when they, I'll just reset it. 147. Open. Welcome. Okay. So when they click change password, the heading changes to change password. Change password goes off. Go back is displayed. And enter old password is displayed. Enter new password is displayed. So what do I do is header dot inner HTML. The value inside the header is actually door lock system. I'm changing it to change password. Submit button, 0 dot display none, which means this site, we have an open button here, right? So with the class name submit button, the class name it returns an array. Here, here I have a lot of button. All the buttons have the class names as submit button. Here we have submit button. Here we have submit button. Everything has submit button here. So I remove the element with submit button index 0 to be none. Submit button at index 3 to be none, which is the open button, and the alert also should be none because we are changing the password. So alert is none. New password is block. So new password is the text box, the second text box, new password. Okay, that should be given as block. And new password is of one is the input box. So that one is also block. And enter password. Enter password is the one with normal enter password, right? This one should be given as enter old password. Now now we are changing the password, so it is not enter password. It should be enter old password. So I'm changing it as in dot inner h1 is equal to enter old password. And go back should be displayed block. So this is what done when change password happens. And as well as when you go back, when you click go back, door lock system should be displayed. Change password should again be displayed. It will be none when we click change password. Now it is again displayed. And this enter new password, the another input box should be displayed none. And this enter password should be again, enter old password will be here. This should be again renamed as enter password. So that function is given all over here. And if they give forgot password, I told that we get an OTP, right? We get an OTP. For that, I create a variable OTP using the math class and a floor method. I use the math class and random method with the maximum value minus minimum value plus 1000. So I create a random integer between the four digit numbers 9999 and 1000, and I save it into the variable named as OTP. So when they click the forgot password button, when they click the forgot password button, the topic changes. Two text boxes and getting displayed. OTP enter password is changed to enter OTP, and go back button is displayed. So all that is done here. And we have to send the OTP to the Telegram, right? So for that Ajax method, Ajax call here for the Telegram chatbot, and I've given the OTP here. OTP variable, and I am also giving the function, and after it is done, console.call response. And for if they want to change the new password, if they enter the new password and click here, click the button change, I'm calling it to new password function, right? So if they click the new password function, if they click the change button, goes to the new password function. There I have to check the old password first, right? Old password first. In case of forgot password, I have to check the OTP if it is correct or not. Or in case of forgot password, I have to check the old password if it is correct. Sorry, change password, I have to check the old password again. So for that, first I have to ensure whether it is forgot password or change password. So I'm checking if the headers inner HTML is forgot password. If it is forgot password, I have to check the OTP. OTP from user, which is the password value, password's value, is equal to the OTP which I've created here. Okay, if it is equal, then I am assigning the password variable, which I've declared globally as 123, to be the value of the new password input variable. So the password has been changed now. So I'm giving the alert and also the Ajax call as password has been changed. Else, if the OTP is wrong, I'm giving an alert as OTP is wrong. If the header is not for forgot password, it is for changed password, then I'm having a variable as old for the old password which they have entered in the first input variable. And I'm checking if the old password equal to the password which I have declared as 123. If it is equal, then I'm changing the new password to be the new password input box's value. And I am also giving the alert and Ajax call again. If the old password is wrong, then I'm giving the old alert as old password is wrong. So that's it about the project. So as I said already, I will talk about the training and the internship. So the training was really useful. and it was worth the money. You can really learn a lot from the training. Trust me. Most of the concepts which I have covered in the training, actually in this session, is actually from the training. And moreover, you can learn a lot deeply in the training. You can also, you also have many assignments to be done. They give you, they have doubt clearing sessions. They have forum forums to clear all of your doubts. You can also learn React.js from the training, which is really useful in today's age. And also, after completing the training, regarding the internship, after completing the training, I got an email regarding the internship of a web developer intern at Bolt IoT, and I thought that I would give it a shot. And all the interview process was, I went through all the interview process, and I was selected. The internship period has also given me great knowledge, and I've learned a lot from this internship. Internship was actually with stipend every month, and the internship was also really useful. You can learn a lot from Bolt IoT's team. They actually really guided me. They helped me a lot to rectify my mistakes and everything. I'm really thankful to Bolt IoT team. So, yeah, that's it. Thank you.